Brother John, welcome to Heartland Community Baptist Church. This is our second online streaming service here from my house, the COVID-19 streaming service. So we're going to run this like we'd run any service. You just heard Brother John play a song. He'll be playing another one in a bit. But first, I'd like to take any prayer requests. So from my family here, do you guys have any prayer requests? Jenny, yes. So Jenny is saying thank you. You want to thank God in your prayers. Amen. That's good. Okay. Pray for our family. Thank you. CJ. Okay. Okay. Any other prayer requests? I got a few here. Barbara Swanson wants us to continue to pray for all those that are sick. With the virus, pray for Francis, Sister Francis, pray for her to find a job soon. Pray for Heather Jones, her mom is still at the hospital with low blood pressure and other ailments. Continue to pray for her. Pray for our nation and the world as they go through this crisis, like something we've never seen before. Pray for them, that they all turn to God. Pray for our church, that we use this as an opportunity to reach people that maybe we wouldn't normally reach with the gospel message. Pray for a humble heart and the right spirit to discern God's will and not be led into temptation. It's very easy to get excited. In fact, I preached about this on Wednesday night, to get excited about things that we want to do and not things that God would have us do. So pray that we have that humble spirit about us all this week and that we don't get led into temptation. Let's pray for soul winning. It's a little difficult during the virus, when we're told to stay inside and we don't want to appear to be spreading it, to knock on people's doors, but pray that we're still good soul winners using the resources that we have, like online streaming, Facebook, social media, to reach the lost. Pray for all the kids on recess. I know that they'll be out for a good bit here. They may not go back to school. So pray for them that this is a time that they can grow closer to God and maybe get away from some of the worldly things that they're exposed to in school and get into the Christian things, the Bible and so forth. I pray for the elderly and all those with health conditions. They're certainly suffering right now. If I were in a nursing home, I would be very anxious right now with all the diseases spreading. Pray that God gives them comfort and pray that their salvation is secure and they know where they're going and God protects them. Pray for softened hearts in this environment. Look, it's constantly changing. People are upset, they're nervous, they don't know what to do. Pray that people turn to God in these just unbelievable times and seek Him with all their hearts. Maybe that hard heart is now softened to hear a gospel message. And pray for those on the front line of this disease and epidemic, pandemic now, the nurses, the doctors. My wife works in the pharmaceutical industry. Those that are researching drugs, those that are in dealing with situations where they don't have enough room in hospitals, those in third world countries or communist regimes where they can't get the support from the government they need, pray that God gives them strength. Philippians 4:13, we can do all things through Christ Jesus. So pray for them. And I'll just go to the Lord in prayer here. You can pray along with me. Excuse me. Dear Lord, thank you for this day, Lord. Instead of staring at a congregation, I'm staring at a camera and my sleepy family on the sofa. But I thank you. I thank you for allowing us to be here today, Lord. I thank you for allowing your sweet blessings on our household and on so many, Lord, that you've provided for in this circumstance. Unbelievably, miraculously, we never expected it would happen, but you've been there through and through, and I thank you for that, Lord. I thank you for how awesome you are and your provision as we look back and see all the things that you've done in my life, my family's life, and those lives of those watching. I just thank you, Lord. We love you, God. And we're asking you, Lord, to remember all those that are on the front lines, God, that are dealing with this virus, Lord, that are courageously fighting it, going in knowing they could get infected and still going and serving others, Lord, with that compassionate heart, Lord. We're so thankful for it. We're thankful for the example that you set before us in Jesus Christ. We're thank you for allowing us to have church, however different it is. We thank you just for everything. And we ask you, God, to remember the ones on the front line, to remember those that are sick. Remember those our family members that are in the hospital, Lord. Remember all of us that are looking for jobs, Lord. Remember those that have a need, God, that are seeking you, Lord, and use your people as you see fit to deliver on those needs, Lord. And we give it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So just a few announcements. Again, I'm just running this like a normal church service. We are, as a church, continuing to read the New Testament. And if you're new to our church, you're welcome to join along in reading the New Testament with us. People say, oh, well, you know, a lot of churches read the Bible in a year. You're only going to read the New Testament. We spent, I think, 7 or 8, 9 weeks on a single verse in the Bible in a message series. There are times where we'll go wide with the Bible and have a lot of verses in a message. And there are times where we'll literally focus on maybe even a word in a verse. So we're not looking for quantity this year, we're looking for quality. And so you're invited to just read the New Testament, and heck, if you're in the area and you read it, like our church reads it, you can come along. I'm going to take everybody to lunch to the Cheesecake Factory, which if you haven't been is a great place. I gave it a free advertisement, but we'll read the New Testament. So start with the book of John, get the Gospels in. Go through the New Testament, take your time with it, know that in a year you can really master a lot of these books in terms of understanding it. And of course, the Bible never fully can be understood on this side of heaven, but you can do a lot of good work in a year. So I urge you to read the New Testament. If you struggle with reading, you can listen to it. You know, there's great New Testament and whole Bible audio online on YouTube and through apps and so forth. So you can listen to it, you can read it, and I encourage you to do that. We have not much going on because of the COVID-19 situation. We're trying to take extra precautions, especially for those that are older in age within our church. So we don't have anything planned really too much. We had a fellowship trip to Chimney Rock that's been postponed. We're trying to go to the Ark Encounter that's been postponed. Church camp, I'm really hoping and praying we'll be able to do that, but we have to see what the schools are going to do. when the kids get back and how much recess there'll be. So we really have everything on hold. The only other announcement is that we will continue to do these online services, Lord willing, for as long as we are kind of asked to be at home and not in groups. So with that, I'll throw it back to Brother John, and then Michelle and Daisy will have the special, and then we'll get to some preaching.
That's all that matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family.
Thank you, Brother John. Thank you, Daisy and Michelle. I appreciate our church coming together. We're a small church. They came together and producing songs in their house, sending them over so we can share them with you. And I appreciate it. And hopefully the hearts are tender for the Lord here this morning. I just want to spend a few minutes. I'm not going to take too much of your time. I want to spend a few minutes talking about the great healer. What are we dealing with right now? This COVID-19 virus. You can't pick up a newspaper, or you can't look at the news online or anything without seeing all of these very scary stories about this virus. And we are truly in a pandemic. And so we're here, and what are we looking for? We're looking for healing. And we're looking for physical healing, a vaccine, medicine, to alleviate this great suffering that's come about us. Everything has just been turned upside down. I'm a big sports fan. All the sports leagues are suspended or canceled or postponed. Trade is coming to a halt because people can't get in the factory and manufacture things. Businesses are being decimated, especially restaurants are being cleared out. Hotels, meeting planners are dealing with so much. It's really hard to fathom what's happening. Maybe in the years to come, we'll understand it. It's that feeling that we get when things are just completely out of our control. And what would make it better? A healing. Now, this world, this life, the Bible tells us not to be worried about what can kill us in this life, but to be worried about the one that could send us to hell or to heaven in the next life. And that's why I want to talk about the great healer. And, you know, many will try to heal themselves or at least calm themselves by doing worldly things. Maybe yoga, that's so popular now. Meditate. Talk with friends. But those things won't truly heal you. It'll just maybe put the worry off for a little bit. Even medicine. It may relieve you of symptoms, but will it really heal you of what's to come? God's got a plan for us, and He's already given us a healer like no other that we can turn to in times like these. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that if you turn to God, you'll be immune from COVID-19 or some virus. What I'm saying is that there's a deeper problem that we're dealing with today, and it's a deeper problem than an illness. And you may say, well, brother, people are dying from this. It's very scary, and I agree. I absolutely agree. However, this life is temporal. 100 out of 100 will die. And when they die, where will they go? And when they go to the next life, because our body is temporal in this earthly form, but our soul lives forever. When they go to the next life, that's eternal, that's forever. So I'm dealing with something much more important and significant than a virus that is currently plaguing our world. And I don't want to downplay that, but there's a great healer that can give us calm now, heal us of our major affliction, and provide for us throughout eternity, and He wants to. So that's what I want to talk to you about today. There's never been a better time to come to Jesus, not just literally be saved, which we'll talk about, but also be close with Him. And look, if you need a little comfort, amen, I've got it for you here in God's Word. So our text verse is the book of Mark, chapter 6, verse 56. So if you have your Bibles, we'll be in Mark 6, verse 56. Mark 6, verse 56. And this is speaking of Jesus here. And whithersoever He entered into villages or cities or country, they laid the sick in the streets and besought Him that they might touch if it were but the border of His garment. And as many as touched Him were made whole. One more time. And whithersoever He entered, this is Jesus, into villages or cities or country, they, the people, laid the sick in the streets. Okay, so Jesus is coming. Let's put the sick in the streets and besought Him that they might touch, even if it were the border. Other scripture in the Bible says the hem, the border, the little bit of His garment, of Jesus' garment. And as many touched Him were made whole. And you could read as that, they were healed, they were made whole. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank You again for this online service. I thank You for allowing us to worship You, Lord. I thank You for the liberties You've given us in this country. I thank You for the hope that we find in our Savior, Jesus Christ. And I'm asking you for this next little bit to use me, to speak through me, what you'd have your people to know, God. I can't do anything on my own, but I know you can do a mighty work through me, Lord. And I know that you can help and heal those that are suffering today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we have in our scripture here in Mark 6:56, a few things happening. First, to give you context on the scripture. So I always like to take scripture within context. Some people, they'll take like I'm talking about people delivering, nurses delivering the sick, and they can't do it in their own strength, and it, mentioning Philippians 4:13. And then you've got, you know, an NBA player throwing that on their shoe, saying, look, I can make $1 million. In context, we have to look at things importantly with scripture. Jesus at this time feeds the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes, okay? So he performs a miracle, feeds the 5,000. This is part of his earthly ministry. He then goes to the mountain to pray, and he sees the disciples on the ship and the waters and the waves and the wind. It's getting very stormy, and so he walks on water to calm the storm. And here in Mark 6:50, he says, be of good cheer. It is I, be not afraid. So when we know when we're in the stormy waters, and this will preach, this is a little extra for you, when we're in the stormy waters and Jesus comes alongside us, we know we don't have to be afraid. And that's really what I mean by the great healer. We don't have to be afraid. He heals our hearts. He takes that fear that the devil tries so hard to use against us and removes it from our hearts. He doesn't give us the spirit of fear. He gives us the spirit of the sound mind, as the Bible says. When the disciples were amazed that Jesus came walking on water, when they were in a storm, they were amazed at this miracle because apparently they had forgot their heart. The Bible says their hearts were hardened by the feeding of the 5,000. So they had already lost track of that. They'd already forgot how miraculous that is. And then Jesus comes and calms the waters. Isn't that what we're dealing with today? Where we already forget what Jesus has done over and over and over, and then we panic about the future, about our present situation, when we should believe and know and have faith in Jesus. So then they came to Gennesaret and on the Sea of Galilee there, and that's where our scripture takes place. And so if you look at Gennesaret, and you look at this area of the Sea of Galilee, it really is almost like a circle of different ministries that Jesus had, that he was miracles he was performing, places he went, all along the water there. It's fascinating to see this body of water. I haven't obviously been there. Anyone that knows me knows I don't travel too much like that, but to see it online, to see pictures of it, to see a map of it, it's really fascinating how you can see where different things happened, where Jesus was able to cast the devils out of that the man and the maniac Gadara, and the swine go flying into the water, and all of the miracles that Jesus performed. And you can see that when you look at a map there of the area. So Jesus is performing miracle after miracle, and people are coming to him to get healed. And I think that, you know, you may say, well, brother, that's a pretty simple scripture, but it's very powerful in what it's teaching us as believers, that we again, we have all of these hopes and these worldly things that'll satisfy us, but nothing truly will satisfy us or heal us of our nature except coming to Jesus, touching Jesus, approaching Jesus. So number one, all that come to him are healed. We have access to Jesus today. So in the scripture, you can just imagine the people in the area taking their sick and pushing them out into the road, piling up, gathering up in masses. In this time period, the scripture will show us that the people were crowding him, the press, the groups were crowding Jesus. They weren't allowing him to get through to even have a meal. Okay, they were just... At a point, he's got to get on a boat because the crowd is so big to separate himself. People were literally fighting to get to Jesus. Well, unbelievably now, through the blood of Jesus, we have access to him directly. We can approach the throne boldly. We don't need to elbow in and try to get room to get to Jesus. We can pray to Jesus. We have access to him today. First step in doing that is accepting the free gift of salvation that Jesus has offered to all of us. So maybe you're watching this video and you don't usually go to church, but you're like, hey, I'll throw it on. What the heck, it's Sunday morning. You know, so-and-so shared it or whatever it is. I want to tell you that the first step here, when I talk about the benefits of believers and the healing in Jesus, the first step is accepting Jesus. We have to accept Jesus as our Savior. We have to be saved, as they call it. And what happened on the cross is Jesus took our sins. So he is perfect, sinless, blameless. He's the Son of God. All of the scripture that I'm mentioning here today, he's performing miracles. Literally, he didn't even need to look at someone. If you touched his garment, you're healed. I mean, he was that miraculous. That good that was in him would just flow out. The centurion, his servant, was sick, and he said, look, I too am over people. I'm a leader, and I'm under people. I know how that works. You don't even need to come to my house. I'm not worthy of you coming into my house. Just think it. Just if you just thought it, it was a thought in your mind, my servant would be healed. That's how miraculous Jesus was and is. And friend, you have to accept him as your Savior. That's the first step to have that close relationship to him, would have any relationship with him. And we'll get to why in a minute, but you have to be saved because we're sinners. We need a Savior. We couldn't do it on our own. Jesus came to die for your sin and my sin. He died on the cross. We have to accept him as Savior. And you can do that today. I'll get to that in a bit, but you can do that today. We were foreknown to God. He loves us and has good plans for us, but only after we accept Jesus. And you say, well, how can you be so confident that you have to accept Jesus? I have another God. I have idols. I'm a good person. I have good works. I have a moral character about me. The Bible says this. The Bible cuts down all arguments in one piece of scripture, John 14:6. It shows that no man can come to the Father but by Jesus, but by me, but by Jesus. So we know the only way to God, the only way to heaven is through Jesus. The Bible clearly tells us that. And we must accept him as Savior. Have you ever seen someone that gets saved and truly means it, so forth? They're saved in church, they come down to the altar. And then after they're saved at some point, they go afar off. You know, they say, you know what? These things of the world, they may not say this, but this is truly what's happening. The temptations of the world are just too great for them to resist. And then they develop a guilt. Maybe they don't want to, you know, maybe they want to just be willfully ignorant. Maybe they just don't want to do the things of God anymore. They don't want to put themselves through that. They don't want to deal with God's laws. So they put it aside. They backslide. You know, there's one thing to be saved, but there's another thing, too, to be close to Jesus. And these are two important things. Because we need to be saved to have our sins forgiven, to have our name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, never to be blotted out or erased. But we also need to be close to Jesus so that we can have God's blessing on our life, have that peace that I'm talking about, have that wisdom, have all of these things the Bible shows us that we'll have when we're close to Jesus. So we need to be close to him. And many people, unfortunately, they get saved at some point, or they're involved in a church and they fade away and they backslide, and the world is really good at getting them in that grip of sin and not ever letting them go on their own. That they have to turn to Jesus. They have to turn to him for their strength. So we must not turn from him once we accept him. Sin creates a distance between us and God. And we all sin, we all fall short. And we need to repent of it. Unrepentant sin, the sin that's in our lives that we flagrantly go about and do each day, that creates a distance between us and God. And that distance, it kills the relationship. If you've ever been in a relationship with somebody, you know how important proximity is, closeness is. Those that have been in the military, those that have to travel for work, you know how hard it is to be away from your spouse, how difficult it is to have that distance. Well, we're called the bride of Christ. You know, the Bible often uses references to a marriage to describe our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we're distant, when we're far off, friend, we are not able to keep that closeness with God. Even just being distant is a problem. But surely, we have a sin nature. And when we're not under God's instruction, we're not under his chastisement, we're living for the world, we just keep drifting further and further away. And that is spiritual adultery. And if you're not saved, that's spiritual fornication. You are outside of your relationship with the Lord, what you're supposed to have, you're turning away from him. So we need to make sure that we're saved, we need to make sure that we're living for the Lord, and we need to make sure that our sin has not created a distance in the gulf between us and the Lord. And you're saying, well, how do I do that? You know, how do I gain that closeness with the Lord? It's very simple. And anyone that comes to our church frequently has heard me preach on this many times. To stay close to God, you literally stay close to God. Get in His Word. Sing His songs. Praise Him. Spend time with other Christians living for Him. Learn His commandments for you and live them. Repent of all sin. Get it under the blood. Give it to the Lord and turn away from it forever. Get away from those that drag you down. Being close to God is an action. It's not a thought or an intention. I intend to run a lot outside, okay? But my action is to sit inside and eat. My intention of running is worthless if my action is just hanging out, right? We must have action about us as Christians. We can't say, oh, well, God will draw close to us. No, the scripture says, draw nigh to Him and He'll draw nigh to you. He's created us. He knows our DNA. He knows our form. He knows we're from the dirt. And He knows that we are prone to drift afar off. And He wants to see who's for real. Who's going to come to Him? So that's point number one. Point number two, why do we need healing in the first place? I can imagine a lost person, probably maybe not getting this far in the video, but if they did, I imagine them being slightly offended by me talking like, oh, man's a sinner, and these, you know, you need to get close to God and get right. And people are thinking, what the heck? Well, you need to get close to God because we have a sin nature. And I'm just going to read a couple of verses from Mark 7 here. I'll grab my Bible that describes our sin nature. I'll start with Mark 7:15. This is Jesus speaking. There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man. So what comes into us, like the food we eat and everything, and these days, it's just going through our stomach, it's being purged out, it's being used for things. But what comes out of us is what defiles us. Verse 20, this is Jesus speaking, and He said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, okay, so out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. Okay, so we have a lot of things, and as I read that scripture in Mark 7, made me think of the works of the flesh in Galatians 5:19-21. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So we have all of these things. If you're like me and you hear this list, you may say to some of them, well, okay, witchcraft, I'm not practicing witchcraft. But maybe you like to watch movies about witchcraft. Maybe you like to look at your astrology sign. Maybe there is a little bit of paganism in you. Idolatry. What's your idol? What thing, if it was taken away, would really leave a gaping hole in your heart? I live near a lake, not on the lake. We couldn't afford that. And I live down the street from a lake. And so when I drive to get gas, to take the kids to school, to pick the kids up, oftentimes I see boats. Nice boats, you know, and people that are taking so much time to put their boat on the trailer, put their boat in the water, go all around about with their boats. Nothing wrong with having a boat. If you know, that'd be great to have a boat. You know, a lot of the ministry that we're speaking of today dealt with the water and so forth, and they had boats. But if that boat takes a place in a man's heart where Jesus should be, that creates a problem. That's an idol. And we really need to make sure that our hearts are clearly aligned, that we're set to Jesus, and that all that space in our heart is reserved for Him. And so the boat is a tool to go fishing or relax a little bit, that's fine. But when it becomes an obsession, when it becomes something you're reading about, when it becomes something you're just lusting for, that's idolatry, and we can't have that. But I can go on and on. Heresy, strife, adultery, not just physical adultery, but spiritual adultery, looking on others with lust, uncleanliness, revelings. You ever meet people that love the fight, love to rebel, to get in trouble, to spur up anger? It's all over the world. So these things, according to our scripture, defile a man. And so you ask the question, what does it mean to defile? The definition of defile is to sully, mar, or spoil. If you were a tender of our church, you watch our videos. Recently I taught on Daniel and the three Hebrew boys that didn't want to defile themselves by taking the king's meat. So this is Old Testament. King Nebuchadnezzar was trying to get them to take the king's meat and the wine. They knew that Nebuchadnezzar was from Babylon and offered this food up to pagan gods. They said, we can't take it. And they literally didn't want to defile themselves. But that's a picture of us, what we deal with today, not so much the eating, but how we defile the problem of our heart, how we defile our heart. And that's kind of dealing with the mind and what we're setting the mind on and how we develop this evilness. And again, you say, well, where do I get this from? Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? You know, if you repeat that verse to yourself every time you feel tempted, it may really make you think about whether your intuition is the best thing for you and for your never dying soul. You say, well, is that happening today? I just plucked a few things out that I saw. I mean, ask any preacher what they think of the world today, any gospel preacher, Bible teacher, Bible preaching teacher, ask them what they think of the world today, and they'll tell you stuff like this. Democrats in government tried to pass new laws in a coronavirus stimulus to remove the Hyde Amendment. And that's the government amendment that protects the government from funding any abortion. It restricts the government from funding any abortion. And we have this horrible virus that's hurting a lot of people. And the Democrats want to make sure that the government can pay for murdering babies. Advocates of abortion try to make the abortion pill an essential treatment and remove doctor oversight in coronavirus legislation. They're asking lawmakers to say, look, abortions are essential. We need to kill these babies in this time of hardship, in this time of distress. These are people's hearts, these deceitful, wicked hearts. Time Magazine, oh, that's a good periodical, Time Magazine, you know, Person of the Year. They retroactively went back and tried to rank the Woman of the Year. And at some point, from what I read, they ranked the founder of the abortion corporation, Planned Parenthood, Woman of the Year retroactively. They just slipped that in. The heart is deceitful. It's wicked. It's, you know, when you read things in the Bible and you say, you know, I can imagine some academic saying, well, man's evolved and man's improved. And here we see men and women working to ensure babies are murdered. Man has not evolved. Man has not improved. Man is wicked beyond belief. And I know that may be offensive, but it's true. And when this title of the sermon, The Great Healer, man needs the great healer. That's what the argument I'm trying to make here. So what can we do to cleanse our sin? We must turn to God for help. God shows us mercy, and that is the kind of mercy that we need. And there's a really good scripture I want to share with you from Luke. If you have your Bible, turn to Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. It's about the Good Samaritan. Luke 10, 25 through 37. Luke 10, 25 through 37. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? So the lawyer is tempting Jesus here. And he said unto him, this is Jesus speaking, what is written in the law? How readest thou? Verse 27. And he answering said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And is that not what you deal with when you try to deal with the upper crust, the religious people that they're all about the tradition and ritual? Do they not do that? Do they not try to bait you in with a question? But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" And Jesus answering said, and this is, gets to the story here, "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, his clothes, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest the way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side." The priest passed by on the other side. "But a certain likewise, a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him, and passed by on the other side." So the priest, obviously of a high religious order, the Levite of a high religious order, they're both passing on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, would be one that usually the Jews would not interact with, viewed as a different class. "As he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host, and said unto him, Take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these three, thinkest thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, He that showed mercy on him. Then said Jesus unto him, Go and do thou likewise." So when we turn to God, we have mercy. We have instruction to be merciful. And you can see great examples of that in this day and age that we're living in, of Christians being merciful on those that are suffering. And that's a picture of not just what we should do as Christians, Jesus instructing this upright lawyer to, hey, this is what you do, but it's also a picture of what God has done to us, that we have been so far gone that God has shown us great mercy. And you say, brother, how has he shown us mercy? Through his son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for us, being a propitiation for sins. And it never needs to get more complicated than that. If we accept Jesus, we turn to Jesus, I could cut the camera right off. If you're saying, hey, I accept Jesus, I'm going to live with it, for him with all my heart and soul and mind, the Lord's going to take care of you. He's going to give you that mercy that we so need. Compassion comes from Christ, the one that is willing to tend to us when nobody else will. That's what happened in this story here, right? Jesus is showing us that God will tend to us when the others won't tend to us. And again, he's not using examples of the world. He's using examples of the quote-unquote church to show people that are not tending to those in need. Now, they may, through rituals, as the Bible says, long prayers, they may do look like they're tending to people, maybe even through good works, but in their hearts work evil. It's that evil manner of the flesh that, if not repented fully and wholly, can leave us high and dry. Christ will take us in our sinful, deformed state, not waiting for us to make a better appearance. It's very important. You know, so much of the world is based upon appearance. I used to teach public speaking, and when I would teach public speaking, I'd talk to my students about artifacts. And what are artifacts? It'd be like an earring, or a nose ring, or a tattoo, or a haircut, or anything that people could judge you on, right? And I would let people know that from academic studies and so forth, you will be judged on your appearance. You'll be judged on your artifacts. Not just what you say, but how you look, how you appear. Is that not true in our society today? I ask you, one day, put on your most ridiculous set of pajamas, or sweats or whatever. Don't fix up your hair, don't do anything. And go around about town and see how people treat you. The next day, put on your best suit, your best formal wear, and go around about town and see how people treat you. And I promise you, you know, the first day they'll look at you like a vagrant, they'll be suspicious of you, and the second day they'll call you sir or ma'am, and they'll be upright because your appearance looks like you've made yourself to look important, right? Jesus doesn't judge us on our outward appearance. He judges us on our hearts. And it's not that we have to be perfect, we just are perfectly imperfect, by turning to Him and allowing Him to come in to our hearts. And then when God sees us, He doesn't see us, the sinful one with all these fleshly desires, all these things that have transgressed the law, as the Bible says. He sees us as the perfect, sinless, spotless blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. That's why it's so important to be close to Jesus. That's why Jesus is the great healer, because we are healed from within. And that means that no matter what happens in this life, whether we die and He takes us home, whether the rapture comes and He calls His church back, or whether we live 100 years, no matter what happens, we are healed through the stripes of Jesus Christ on the cross. Christ came to heal the sick and set the sinner free. And when we have Christ, we have forgiveness and we are forever changed. So when you're saved, no matter what happens after that, you're forgiven for your sins. Your name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, never to be blotted out, never to be erased. And you're forever changed. I can tell you that when I was saved, when I was roughly 22 years old, when I was saved, my life changed. And I lived not like I should for many years. And I lived in had torment. I think probably had a special torment. I really think when I got saved, things seemed to get a little worse so that they could get better, so that I could learn what the Lord was doing in my life, so that I could learn how much the Lord desired a closeness with me, and truly how wicked I am and how wicked we all are as people, and that we have to turn to God. He's a fearful God. He's a mighty God. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom. We must fear God. And so Christ has come to give us forgiveness. We're forever changed, and it's a relationship. It's an action step that we have to walk each day. Finally, our hope should be in eternity in the great healer Jesus. If we look at the now, it can be very frightening. Maybe some of you have lost a job. Maybe some of you will lose your home or your car or, you know, everything from the coronavirus or from the recession that's to come or whatever it is. It can be very frightening. But our hope in Jesus can satisfy us today. He can give us peace today. But also it can deliver us throughout eternity, and so that forevermore we can have assurance in Jesus. But you may say, well, what do you mean by hope? Well, where is your hope today? Is it in a bank account? Is it in the government? Is it in your job or family? It should only be in Jesus. What's the definition of hope? A feeling of expectation and desire for a certain thing to happen. A feeling of expectation and desire for a certain thing to happen. So for our expectation, we should expect Christ to honor His promises. And that should be our expectation. What are His promises? Do you know that the Lord Jesus Christ makes us many promises in the Bible, us as believers, those that are saved? He makes us many promises in the Bible. And our expectation should be that He will honor these promises. And what are some of the promises? Well, life. John 3:16 tells us we're going to have eternal life, and that means that we're never going to die, that we're going to live forever with Him. Death can be a very scary thing, but it won't be when you know that you're with the one that has defeated the grave, that's overcome the grave. So we're promised life. We can have hope and acceptance. John 6:37, we know that we'll never be cast out. We'll always be accepted by Jesus. In this world, it's so easy to go afoul. It's so easy to hurt someone's feelings. It's so easy to be cast out, but with Jesus we'll never be cast out. We'll always be accepted. We'll have a great reward. Our hope can be in our reward. Mark 10:29-31, we have a great inheritance later on for our service now. A revelation. So when we're saved and we're living for the Lord, we have this promise of revelation. John 14:21, our love for Him leads to Jesus manifesting Himself to us. So as we grow close to Jesus, as we live for Jesus, then what happens is we start understanding more of Jesus. We are revealed more of His plan, of what God is doing with the world, of what are the things to come. We are given revelation. Doesn't mean that you'll be making new prophecies up and calling yourself an apostle. It doesn't mean that. But it just means we can better discern and understand God's word. If anyone spends time with the Lord, I think I can get an amen from that or for that, because truly you spend time with the word, you learn, you understand, you study, you spend time in prayer, and God reveals things to you. Friendship How important is friendship? So important. John 15, 14 through 15. Following commands of Jesus faithfully leads to being called a friend. It leads to being called a friend of God. How would you like to be a friend of the Creator in the literal sense, like a close, good friend? You know, what do you have when you have a close friendship? You have liberty. You have fun. You can share each other's resources. If I have a close friend and they need to borrow my car, here's my car. If they want to come over to dinner, come over to dinner. You know, we do things together. That's what friendship is. And the Bible tells us that in John 15, 14 through 15, we will be called a friend of Jesus when we follow his commands faithfully. Joy. We're going to have joy. John 15, 9 through 11. Jesus kept God's commandments and has joy. We keep his, Jesus' commandments, and we'll have joy. Joy like no other. The world can't understand this kind of joy. This joy is perfect. It's unbelievable. The best way I can describe it is that it's indescribable, but the second best way I can describe it would be like when you're a kid and you're so excited about something. I remember being 3 or 4 years old and someone gave me a Spider-Man toy, and I don't remember much else other than the feeling overwhelmed me because I was so excited about this toy. I was like beside myself. I couldn't speak. I was just too busy smiling and being joyful. It's that kind of joy times a billion that we have in the Lord. That's John 15, 9 through 11. And persecution? Yeah, I put persecution on God's promises. The reason why, Matthew chapter 5, 10 through 12, we are blessed by God when persecuted for his name's sake. Well, what does that mean? That means even when we're persecuted for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we're still blessed by him. Amen? We are still blessed. God's saying, look, you're going to have problems in this world. This world's wicked. I've told you that. You go out. You preach my word. You go out. You try to reach the lost. You do these things I've called you to do. You're going to get some pushback. You're going to have some problems. But the Bible says, look, if you go to witness to an area, this is what the Lord Jesus Christ was saying to the disciples when he sent them out two by two. He said, you go to an area and they throw you out and they don't want to hear it. Just, you know, dust off your shoes for a testimony. As in, when God judges them, he will say, when they say, oh, I didn't know about you, Lord, or I didn't have time, God will say, remember when I sent Clark Covington to your house? Remember when I had that video? Remember when I had that recording and you didn't listen to him? There's the dust on his shoes as a testimony that he gave you the good word, and he gave you the gospel truth, that he told you about my son, Jesus Christ. Well, that testimony that we have will also earn us rewards. We'll be blessed in heaven for serving the Lord. So we know we won't ever die. We are forever with our Maker in paradise. We have a royal inheritance. We have understanding in godly things that others don't. We have a friend in our Savior. We have joy like nobody can describe. And even when people hate us and slander us for believing in him, we get blessings in heaven for it. This is our true hope. You know, it changes your whole perspective. You look at things like, you know what? Whatever happens to me now, it doesn't matter. I have hope in all these things. God the Maker, the one that made the trees outside, the planet, the roads, the sky, the air, the water, everything. God the Maker made these promises to you, the believer, and to me, the believer. That's our true hope. Well, what does the world offer? You know, the world is so tempting, right? What does the world offer? Financial security? What good is that if you die? Can you take it with you? Oh, I can leave it for an inheritance to someone else. Great, so someone else can put their faith and trust in something that will not give them eternal life and not give them God's promises. Financial security is worthless. You could, there's a good story, parable in the Bible about a man that looked out over all his harvest. He had these barns full of all of these great things. He laughed and said, look, I've got all this stuff. I'm just going to kick back and enjoy it. And the Lord calls him a fool and says, your soul will be required of you tonight. Now what are you going to do? Where will that stuff go? It's foolish. Financial security is nothing. Popularity, we all want to be liked, right? Well, what will popularity get you when those people turn on you? You know, the Bible talks about being a lukewarm Christian is despicable to God. So if you're popular with a crowd that doesn't believe, like I'm speaking about, truly in Bible-based fundamental Christianity, then you're not going to be popular for long. They're going to turn their backs on you as soon as you go against their sin. Education. What good is it when you have no way to apply it? What good is your education when you're gone? What does it really matter? People in academia, they boast of themselves so much, they put their faith and their trust in education. Education was not murdered on the cross for our sins and risen from the grave by God himself. Education didn't do that, and education cannot buy you what Jesus bought you. Looks, vanity, hey, a lot of people want to look good. I was mentioning artifacts. I was mentioning about that. You know, you want to look good. You want to have a way about you that people see you and they like you, and they're, and you know, some people could even be narcissistic where they have to look good. They feel like the whole world revolves around them, and they go to the gym all the time and they get haircuts. Maybe they even hit the tanning bed, which I've heard is pretty bad for you. Well, this kind of look, you want to look a certain way, this vanity, what good does it do when you get older? What good does it do when it fades away? What good does it do? Again, did vanity die on the cross? No. Vanity is a joke. It's superficial. It's literally skin deep. You can look so great and it will do nothing for you. So vanity is what the world puts their hope and their trust in. You say, true, is that true? Look at the beauty market. Look at the beauty product market. Look at celebrities. It's all about look. It's all about vanity. Power. Many people lust for power. What happens when it's gone? What good is that power if it's temporary? I mean, all of our power, even the devil's power, and the devil's a fallen angel, is great power. The devil's power and all of our power, all earthly power, all power is in submission to Jesus Christ our Lord. Our God has all power, which means we don't have all power. Desire, you know, are we craving for his return or are we comfortable in the world? You know, all of these things that I mentioned, people get very comfortable in. Can you imagine? Just imagine for a minute and I'll wrap up here. Can you imagine if you were a millionaire, multi-millionaire, okay? What's big in this society now? A billionaire. And if you were popular, I mean, you had just thousands of friends and you were so educated. I mean, you had a PhD, you had an MD, you had a law degree, you just had all the degrees. You're super educated, multimillionaire, billionaire, very popular. You looked amazing. You looked like a movie star. And you were ruler over a whole area. You were ruler over a big kingdom. Is that not, I mean, it's funny we mentioned this verse earlier about Nebuchadnezzar and Daniel and the three Hebrew boys. You know, is that not what happened with the writing on the wall? That the king had everything, that he had great power and great wealth, and had everything he could desire and all his desires, and it was all taken from him like that. Friend, the Bible tells us that Jesus is going to come back in the twinkling of an eye, in the quickest of reflexes, in less than even a blink, just it'll happen. And all of these things will be erased. All these things the world is telling you to strive for, all these things that maybe in your heart you desire, will be gone. And all that will matter is what you did on this earth for Jesus Christ. That's all that will matter. That's it. Not what you did through religiosity or through ritual, but what you did for the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart. You might want a new cell phone or a house or a job or a car, but does it really satisfy you forever? Or is it just for a season? And then the desire returns and never seems to go away. Really good piece of scripture. I preached on this not too long ago. I think the name of the message is Never Enough, if you want to look it up. Proverbs 27:20. Hell and destruction are never full, so the eyes of man are never satisfied. You have these desires. They don't go away. They just return. You want something, and then you go ahead and get it, and then you want something else, and you go ahead and get it. And it's almost childlike, where you just see this process happen over and over again, and the person that is involved in the process never gets to the point where it just says, enough of these superficial things. Give me the living water. Give me the fruit of life. Give me what really matters. Give me my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We must not let our inner man and our sinful flesh lead us in desires of the world that are neither satisfied or worth troubling over to begin with. It's just not worth it. It's not worth it. Our desire, wholly and fully, should be in Jesus. He is the one that can make our hearts content. Remember, I call this message the Great Healer because Jesus can make our hearts content. He can calm our stormy waters in our soul like he calmed those waters in the Sea of Galilee. He can calm them. He's the one that makes our heart content. Do you know he desires to greatly love and be close to you? But do you desire the same? Think about who Jesus is. John 15, verse 13. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. What did Jesus do on the cross? Did he not die for our sins? Think of God sending his only begotten son to die for sinners that would largely turn their back on him, and yet he still did it. That's how good God is. And that is how sweet a friend in Jesus is. We should be close to him because he wants to be close to us and because he made that sacrifice. He was the best friend that we could ever have, and he is the best friend that we could ever have. And we need to really draw close to him, draw close to the great physician, to be healed not from the worldly things that may come at us, not just from those, the stress and all the problems. And he can take care of those. I mean, he can work miracles if he chooses. But I don't want to get it twisted that it's some kind of prosperity gospel. Hopefully by now you know it's not. This is a message about what our Savior can do for us. And he can save us from everlasting torment in hell and put us in paradise with him. And his direction, his commandments, they're what's best for our life. They're what give us meaning. That's what gives us purpose. That's what gives us true joy, is to be close to him, be in fellowship with him. He doesn't want us to go astray. What happens when you go astray? If Kobe is 14 and a half, he looks like he's 25, okay, but he's 14 and a half. If he walked off and he went astray, and let's say he just kept walking, what would my concerns for Kobe be? Well, he has no money. I don't know that he has survival skills. He doesn't have a cell phone. He's gone astray. I would worry, like, if he was gone for a long time, that he could get scammed, because he's never been in the world, so someone could probably scam him out of whatever he does have. I'd worry about, you know, where he'd find food to eat. There'd be all kinds of problems if he went astray, right? And the Bible shows us that even if there's 99 sheep that are fine, but one has gone astray, that the Lord goes and gets that sheep. And so it would be like, as the father of Kobe, going to get him, right, and bringing him back into the fold to make sure he's okay. That's what Jesus wants to do with you today. He wants to bring you back to him so that you're okay. He wants the best for you. Friend, as the preacher, I'm here to tell you God loves you. He loves you. You know, and a lot of hard preaching in here, a lot of talking about the works of the flesh and these things, but that's our form, and God, the great physician, is diagnosing our problem and giving us the prescription to heal us from that problem. And it's the greatest thing that we can do is turn to him. And literally these last days, who knows what holds, you know, what tomorrow holds, but today, right now, can be the day of salvation for you. So if you're saved, I'm calling you to get close to God, to draw nigh to him. And if you're unsaved, I'm calling you to accept him right now, wherever you are. Look, you can say this prayer and you can accept Jesus as your Savior right now and be saved forever. You can pray this prayer with me, and then we'll be done here. Dear Lord, I'm a sinner, and I know I need a Savior, Lord. I know that I can't do it, but you can, God. Please come into my heart. Be Lord in my heart. Come into my heart, and I will make you Lord. I won't be ashamed of you. I will turn to you. I accept you as Savior. I know I can't do it on my own, Lord. I'm turning to you in all ways, accepting you as King of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've prayed that prayer, you're saved. And if you're saved, hallelujah, the Bible says there are angels in heaven celebrating. You'll never be the same. And I ask you now, don't be ashamed of it. Tell everybody you can about your transformation, and stay close to Jesus. And for those that are saved already, continue to draw close to Jesus. Continue to get into God's Word. Don't spend all day on the news. I can tell myself that. I get wrapped up in all the stuff going on, that I have to just get into God's Word and understand how much God loves us and how he can help us. And you'll see that just like a child learning to walk, as you take steps for the Lord, things will come together, and all of a sudden movement will come and great things will come your way. And I believe with all my heart, Jesus Christ is the great healer. And let's turn to him, for it's eternally too late. I thank you so much for your attention today, and I will see you soon.